worth of the life.
John, in the practice, you accept the AMR, you start out at one point saying, I don't believe it's Sasquatch, this isn't a book for believers. It's a book about an investigation that's not meant for believers. Where do you think the investigation stands now? And what would you like to see bring it to believers?
Well, actually, that's a very timely question, because I think DNA evidence may finish this whole thing in a matter of weeks, months. Getting very, very close. And that's the way I see it now. I know I've gone for 30 years, I guess, figuring I probably would never live to see the end of this. And of course, most of the people I work with have not lived to see it. But I think that we no longer need a body, and the DNA will establish the existence of a separate species for very long. Was there a second part?
That was it. John, I was wondering if you could talk about the Albert Ostman interview, and it must have been incredulous for you at the time, at the beginning, really, of your research, to meet someone with one of the most incredible Sasquatch stories ever told, probably the most incredible story ever told. And when, after getting all the details, you really started to realize that you were believing this man was telling you the truth.
Well, I don't remember when I just first heard of or read this story, but I do know that both Randy Dan and myself didn't pay any attention to it. I was a wild yarn. Carry on. And then what happened is that an experienced radio news reporter came up to this area to see me because he was in considerable confusion. As he put it, if he had interviewed Ostman, and if Ostman wasn't telling the truth, he didn't know if he had ever interviewed anyone who was. It was just about his exact word. So then we went and talked to Ostman, and he proved to be a delightful personality. You know, there's nothing obviously indicating that he would be a storyteller other than the nature of his story. And I took the local magistrate, who had been a defense counsel before he retired there, who cross-examined him in a way that left me feeling very awkward and embarrassed that I had subjected this Ostman to it. But it didn't faze him a bit. He told his story. And on a later occasion, I took Darris Swindler, the author of the Atlas of Comparative Anatomy of Ape and Human, and also the veterinarian from the Federal Primate Center at the University of Washington, who was also the veterinarian for the big apes at the Seattle Zoo. And these two experts questioned Ostman for half an afternoon. And then we went for coffee afterwards. They said, well, if he didn't have this experience, he must have had a period in his life when he really had an opportunity to observe great apes, because he had never said anything that didn't make sense. And so that's one side of the picture. The other side is that nobody, including myself, has been able to relate the actual geography where he said he went into the bush to the location where he went out of it. The story would require this creature who had carried him up and down over several mountain ranges in the course of part of the night. So, you know, significant thing is that Osman wasn't alone in this, but he was going totally against the common understanding of Sasquatch, which was well known in this area, and was supposed to be a giant Indian with long hair, where he's, you know, describing something totally different. And of course, there's so much detail in what he says. I can't go very far into it, but I don't know, and I don't think we will ever know, but that he was able to construct a detailed picture that through the years, either that's what these things are, or everybody since has been copying Osman. Yes?
Yeah, there's been a lot of discrepancies in regards to reports for his story, basically on his opportunity for escape. Did he elaborate on that with you, and can you elaborate on that with us?
I didn't catch all of that. There's been different reports
of what happened and how he was able to escape. I'm just wondering if he told you the actual story of how he escaped, so that...
His entire story was written. Another man who... You have to realize that at this time there was a big fuss going on about Sasquatch. And there were so many stories that the two daily newspapers in Vancouver were each listing Sasquatch on their front page. And one of these people that had ended his story by saying he didn't know what these were, and Osman got in touch with this man and said he knew what they were. So then this man arranged for the newspaper, somebody, to come and interview Osman, and it told him that this person was coming. So Osman sat down and tried to reconstruct everything he could remember, and wrote it all out in a book. So that's where the story you read comes from. So I kind of lost my way as to what I should be answering. Sand, it was a shock. You know, a real recording, there's something happening, is there is something to this. But when I saw the movie, I had no reaction at all. I just, oh yeah, there is one. You got a picture of one. And later on, we expected that, we knew he had some footprint cast. And Renee and I had just been down in California 6 weeks before and come back with casts of what we call the 15-inch print and the 13-inch print. And we naturally expected that what he would show us would be, you know, which ones are going to be. And my friend Dr. Melbourne, notwithstanding, it wasn't either of them. It was a print we'd never seen, and we'd seen a lot of prints of the 15. On that one occasion, a great many prints of the 13 also. And then afterwards, when we were discussing this, there was this little yellow Kodak box, I think we probably all remember, that was just sitting there on the table. And Renee had one with some of his film in it, and I wondered ever since why he didn't just switch. Wanya, who was Randy's wife at the time, is probably laughing at that harder than anybody. But, I have almost no memory left. If there was more to that question, you'll have to tell me what it was.
How involved were you with the William Rowe story?
I never met William Rowe because he moved away very shortly after. But when I was mistakenly had the idea that sworn statements would help in getting scientists to pay some attention to this, I wrote to him, and he went to the trouble of going to an official in Edmonton and having his story sworn to. And he also had his daughter draw the picture that I think most of you must have seen in a book somewhere, sent that to me. But I never met him, never spoke to him. I did, on a later occasion when I was traveling across Canada selling my books, encountered in two different cities, two different scientists that I went to see who said that they had regularly corresponded with William Rowe about buffalo and that he was an excellent observer of wildlife. But as I say, I have nothing personal to recall. Oh, somebody had their hand up, but they're just adjusting their count. Ivan was writing a book about North American ecology and traveling around the United States, and somebody sent him a clipping of a magazine article based on what I'd been doing, as a result of which he took a side trip to Willow Creek to talk about the big footprints, and then he came up to see me at my home, and that's the only time I was ever with him, but I took him to see Osman and to see the chaplains from the Ruby Creek site. He was involved in us getting together with Tom Slick. We had the idea that Slick was financing research in the Himalayas into the bottom of Snowland. Maybe he would finance us. And we knew that Sanderson knew him. So this is all very blurred now. It's 50 years ago. Sanderson was greatly involved. Well, I think he was officially the scientific part of the, what was called, at Slick's insistence, the Pacific Northwest Expedition. And it wasn't in the Pacific Northwest, and it was an expedition where other people were picking berries, but anyway, that's what it had. has a fame now out of all proportion to what anyone's ever actually meant. And then after Slick brought Peter Byrne over, that was in the lab. And then real research went on from then on. How did they get away over there? I've forgotten the question. Did I answer what you wanted? Okay. Yeah.
John, one of the many wonderful things I find in your book, from a science perspective, was the structured interviews you did, accumulated the database, where not just a bunch of stories, but consistency and characteristics that you worked about. How do you decide to do that? Did you come up with that on your own, or suggest it?
I think that seemed the natural thing to do when you're trying to learn about something.
I think it's a monumental contribution where you, I think one of the chapters you have, which you call, I think it's titled, What is a Sasquatch? Where you go through sort of cross classification. It's just a wonderful piece of science writing.
Yeah, I used to put things on file cards in the beginning. Not right in the beginning. The beginning was totally unstructured. Gradually. Make a file card for each incident and I knew about them and saving them in a loosely minor any detail that I had. Then I started putting things on maps and markers on the maps were just pins they had. Number, size, time of day, a lot of stuff you could get. If you had the key to it, you could read out the map. And then when the computer age came in, actually before it was really in, the outfit called American National Enterprises wanted to get a Sasquatch movie of their own. I think they'd been negotiating with Roger and Mike's Price, and wanted to do a computer survey, so I handled that for them, got a lot of other people involved. So then we had the stuff in the computer. And after we had several hundred reports, you know, down on punch cards, I don't know what happened after that. I do know that when we went to the University of BC, where they were recording this on the mainframe, somebody had to run down the basement and get a big tape and put it up somewhere on the computer. And it only took us an hour or two to realize that we didn't have enough information to introduce to anybody. Just, it'd be a couple of hundred questions on a form and 10 answers. And, well, yes?
What, Joe, what was your most exciting thing that happened to you in your years of Sasquatch? What, is there anything that really stands out that you really enjoyed or had the most excitement with?
Yeah. I was trying to get down to Bluff Creek from Cedar Hill Camp Road, which is on the opposite side of where the regular road is. I was driving an old Ford station wagon on an abandoned road, and I went around the right-angle corner and came up upon a log about this thick right across the road. And it was the middle of the night, and I had an old part of a logger saw this log in my car. And I had to get out there in the dark, woods behind me where all the Sasquatches were, and saw that. That made an indelible impression. The other thing is, see, I couldn't go back. It was too steep. I had to go up, get down and turn around. Yes?
Before you got involved in this, or before you met Gilbert and Renee, what was your opinion of Bigfoot?
Well, I grew up with the Sasquatch. And, you know, and it was supposed to be a giant Indians with long head hair, and they had fires and they had villages. And then we started, And by the way, the Indians are not to blame for this, because when they had a big Sasquatch Day celebration here back in the 1940s, the Indians contributed the Sasquatch, and it was totally covered with fur and didn't have long hair. So they knew what they were talking about. But, you know, the overall community didn't. Well, again, I've lost track of where I'm going.
I was wondering, what was your own personal opinion on the phenomenon?
Well, I didn't have any idea personally until I talked to some witnesses, and they described something much more like an ape than a human. And then after I saw the footprints in the hard sand, it was obviously something that weighed many times what a human weighed. I mean, I couldn't make a complete footprint, just the heel was outlined completely. We didn't have tread on our boots in those days. All of the sole was just a flat area with no edges. And I'm just beside these tracks that you're seeing some here that sink in like that. And that's, you know, that's what really settled things. I've been trying to find out ever since what makes those tracks. You know, nobody to this day has produced any way that humans can do it. You know, the big alternative in this whole subject is it an animal or is it a human activity that's involved? Human activity won't explain anything unless you haven't looked at it. Yeah.
Two more.
John, did you have to debate with yourself very much about becoming the public person who's going to stand up and say, hey, there's something out here, or did you, you know, really consider that a lot, or did you just do it?
Yeah, that bothered me. I'm pig-headed.
Do you think you paid a price for that? Do you think you paid a price?
No, I had a ball. Maybe the luckiest thing that ever happened to me is that when I first went down to California, saw footprints, my wife was with me. You know, she's gone along with all this nonsense. She's been in it from the beginning and had seen footprints for herself. That's quite an interesting incident. We were taken to the Bluff Creek site on the road where there was supposed to be a nice fresh set of tracks. But the logger we were following got there ahead of us and came back to it when we finally arrived and said, sorry, they've backladed them all this morning. So, you know, oh yeah, sure. And then he said, but look around, you'll find some. So my wife opened the door on her side to get out of the car. And if she had looked, she would have stepped right in the footprint. It was an older one, it wasn't a good one, but as long as your arm. So had no average. I've never had any problems that some people have had. Where the people closest to you think you're an idiot. No way you could get a machine to that location, but of breaking down brush on the side. Couldn't even do it with a helicopter because there was a camp right there. Here are these tracks in this hard sand.